Hey, this is René, and today I want to show you how you can write your own stochastic expert advisor that will trade completely automated to make profits on the Forex market. This tutorial will be a beginner's tutorial, so even if you do not have any coding experience, you should be able to follow along. Just take your time and do all the steps that I do to write your own expert advisor. Before we start, I have to give you some recommendations. You will have the best learning effect if you really follow my steps. So if I write lines, you should copy them on your own laptop or computer. And it is not enough to simply watch the video, so it's really important that you follow all of my steps and that you do your own thinking. So if I explain something, take your time, maybe pause the video and think about it. And this will lead to the best results for you. And so you will be able to write your own expert advisors in the future. Another very important information before we start this video. We have a sponsor for this video.
This video is brought to you by Trading Deals. Trading Deals works with many of the best known brokers and offers cashback for your trading or other great benefits. Trading fees are often underestimated, but have a huge impact on your trading performance and can even make the difference between winning or losing. Click on the first link in the description and try Trading Deals for free.
Yeah, I'm super glad that Trading Deals decided to sponsor this video because many of you guys already requested more videos on trading topics and more programming tutorials. And because of Trading Deals, I was able to produce this video. So you should definitely check the link below this video and yeah, look on the Trading Deals website if it has some benefits for you. But to start with this tutorial, what we are going to do is we will program an expert advisor, which is a automated trading software in the MetaTrader 5. And this expert advisor will use the well-known stochastic indicator, which is an oscillator. So this indicator trades with overbought and oversold markets. And you can see it below the Euro US dollar chart here. I already attached the indicator to the chart. And it has two lines. There is a main line and a signal line. And you can see that the these lines cross at some points. And there are several common trading strategies using the stochastic indicator. And one of the most known trading strategy is to trade these crossovers. So whenever there is a crossover like here, we would place a buy position to benefit from these from the increase in the in this market. And whenever there is a cross in the other direction, we would sell. So we buy at the very at the bottom, if there is a cross at the bottom of this indicator window, and we sell if there is a cross at the top of the indicator window. There are several improvements or adjustments you can make to this rather simple strategy. For example, you could say that we only want to trade if the crossover takes place above 80, for example, and below 20. And you can, of course, adjust these boundaries to 70 and 30 or whatever you think would be the best setting for this strategy. So that's what we are going to do in the first place. We will also learn some more things about the functionality of an expert advisor. We will learn how we can define input variables so the user of this program can define the settings and the trading environment without looking into the source code. And we will also have a trailing stop to make profits and to secure our trades so we do not make losses when we are in the profitable area once. So to start off, we will have to open the Meta Editor. This is the tool that we use to write our code, and it's pretty much where all the magic happens. So if you are if you opened your MetaTrader 5 already, you can find it at the very top. If you go to Tools and then click on MetaQuotes Language Editor, and it will open the MetaQuotes Language Editor. Then you can see the navigator at the very left side. If you do not see the navigator, you can go to View and click on Navigator, which will open or close the navigator. And there you have the Experts folder. This is the relevant folder where we can place automated trading programs, like the software for it, which is called Expert Advisor in the MetaTrader 5. And when we click on Expert, we can click on New up here and create a new Expert Advisor. Just click on Next several times. And here we first have to enter a name for this trader. We can call it Stochastic Trader, but you can choose any other name that you think suits for this program. So I will call it Stochastic Trader and click on Next several times now. And this will automatically create a MQ5 file, as you can see up here. And this MQ5 file is automatically placed in the Experts folder. And if I do a right click here, I can say Open Containing Folder. And this will open the Experts folder, you can see it up here, for this specific MetaTrader 5. So we should see the MQ5 file here, which is named stochastictrader.mq5. And this is the source code, which we now see in the MetaQuotes language editor. And if I compile this program, which I can do by clicking this compile button, it says that the code is generated and we produced a EX5 file. And this EX5 file is now an executable MetaTrader 5 Expert Advisor. And this is the program which we can see in our MetaTrader in the navigator. If you do not see the navigator, go to View Navigator again and you should see the navigator. And in the Expert Advisor section here, we can now see the Stochastic Trader, which we could possibly already activate on any chart, like I do here. Yeah, you can see it is the Stochastic Trader, which has the version number 1.00, and it is it has a copyright by MetaQuotes Limited. And we can change all this in a second. But first of all, I can activate this Expert Advisor. And if I now go to the toolbox, you can see in the Experts tab, there will be several print statements in a second. But let us go back to the source code. This is the source code for the Stochastic Trader, which is pretty much only the Expert Advisor basic template, which is automatically generated by the MetaQuotes language editor. And you can see all these gray lines, which are comments. So these comments are only for the programmer, and we can erase them without any impact on the functionality of the program. So we can erase all these comments. I think it is more, it is easier to read the code without these comments in specific, but there might be situations where you want to place comments. Comments can be used to show what several parts of your program do. So if you want to, if you think, some explanation might be beneficial for a section in your code, you can do two of these slash signs, which will indicate a comment line. So I can write this is a comment, and this does not, this has no effect on the program. If I erase only one of these slash signs, there will be an error, and I cannot compile this program. So I always have to place two of these signs before writing a comment line. If you have a multi-line comment, you can write only one of these slash signs and this little star sign here. And you also have to close the comment section by using the same signs, but in the in a different order. So this is a comment, and this is also a comment. Make sure to have some typos in between. if I compile this again, you can see this is working, and because I now have a comment section which includes several lines. So everything between these two signs here is a comment now. So you have these two options to write comments. Right now we do not need any of them, but I wanted to make sure that you know how a comment looks if you encounter one. So what we now have left here is three lines with properties, and you can see that there is a copyright property which we can modify to make it our own program pretty much. So I can write the copyright with my own name, and I can use a different link, maybe a link that leads to a German website, which is www.bmtrading.de, and I can also modify the version number. And you can see if I compile these changes, and if I now go to right click properties of Stochastic Trader, you can see these changes already took place here. There is the new version number, which is 1.01, and there is the property with my own, the copyright with my own name. And if I click on it, it leads to our German, our German website pretty much. Yeah, it takes some time, but it is working. So make sure that you use these properties as you want to use them, and if you do not want to use them at all, you can also erase all of them, and it does not affect the program. There are just less information if you click on the expert advisor. So with that said, we can now focus on programming the actual program. So first of all, I want to make some adjustments with these brackets. I will always have the opening bracket, which is this one, at the end of a function name, and the closing bracket at the very beginning of the last line after a function, or the first line after a function. Make sure that you always realize the difference between these curly brackets here and the rounded brackets. Rounded brackets are used in different situations than these curly brackets, and they are not, you cannot exchange them without causing an error. So if I write a round bracket at the opening of the function body, there will be a compilation error. If I use the curly brackets, everything is fine. So what is a function? A function is pretty much a piece of code which is executed whenever the function is called. And we have three functions already, which are system functions. So these functions are not called by the program called code, but they are called by the MetaTrader 5. So whenever an expert advisor is initialized or activated, this onInit function is called. And I can show you this exact functionality by writing a print statement in the function body of this onInit function. A print statement is the print function is another function which is also a predefined function in the MQL5 framework, and it is used to make a print statement in the experts tab. The experts tab is this tab in the toolbox in the MetaTrader 5. So if I use this print statement, and I will explain in more detail how we can use print statements or in general functions later, but I can show you this print statement at the moment. So if I use this print statement in the onInit, you can see that after the compilation, it is produced in this experts tab. And whenever I remove this expert advisor, and I can clear this and if I activate this expert advisor again, you will see that there is this print statement, and it is also called whenever I change the time frame, because before the new time frame is loaded, the old time frame is deinitialized. So the event of changing a time frame causes two function calls in the expert advisor, which is, first of all, the onDeIn function is called onDeInit, and I can visualize it by writing another print statement in the body, which is indicated by these curly brackets, of the onDeInit function. So if I compile this, you will now see, whenever I change the time frame, the program, the expert advisor, is deinitialized first in the old time frame, and then initialized again in the new time frame. And you can see it here, it is deinitialized in the M1 chart, and it is deinitialized in the 1 minute chart, and initialized again in the 5 minute charts. And if I go to the 50 minute charts, it is of course deinitialized in the M5 chart and initialized in the M15 charts. And that's pretty much all you have to know for now for these two functions here. They are called automatically by the MetaTrader 5 whenever the expert advisor is initialized and deinitialized. Okay, we will get to parameters and everything later if we need it in this tutorial. But let us first look at the last function. The onTick function is pretty much the most important function in most of the expert advisors, because this function is, as the name says already, is called whenever there is a tick in the chart. And a tick is a small change in the price of the underlying symbol. I cannot show it to you right now because when I record this video, it is Saturday. So I will have to simulate price movement, which I can do by using the strategy tester. You can open it if you click on view and then strategy tester. And the strategy tester is used for simulating automated programs in the MetaTrader 5, like the stochastic trader. And if you compile it without an error, like I did here, you will see it in the experts tab here. But first of all, if you are still in the overview section here, you have to click on visualize. Then you can choose the program that you want to test, like the stochastic trader. You can make all the relevant settings here that you want to use for this test, and then you can click on start. If I do this now, we can see the program simulates the ticks in the past. And you can see that there is indeed a print statement whenever there is a tick. So we can wait for a tick here. Oh, you can see, yeah, it is going pretty fast. But you can see whenever there is a tick, there is also a print statement because the onTick function is automatically called. Okay, enough for backtesting for now. And let's go back to our program code. So what we learned already is that we have predefined functions which we can use to capture events in the MetaTrader 5, and we will use these functions to do all the relevant steps that we need to do to trade the stochastic strategy that I already explained. But to be able to do so, we will have to do some calculations first. The most important thing for us is to realize the moment where these two lines cross. So what we need first is the stochastic indicator and the data that comes from it. So in the MetaTrader 5, you have predefined functions for the most common indicators. And we can use it for this stochastic. The function is called iStochastic. And this iStochastic function, you can just write like I do. You write an I, then you write STO, and you can see the autocomplete already suggests the stochastic function. And if I click on enter now, it automatically completes the command that I wanted to type. And the iStochastic function is a function that creates a handle. And a handle is a tool that we can use to define a specific indicator. This handle will be useful for us because later on we can use the handle to show the computer what exact indicator we want to generate and receive data from. So this iStochastic function has several parameters. And whenever you call a function, you can use, or you have to open the parameter section by using round brackets. You have already seen this before in the onInit and onDInit function. And there is a difference. The onInit function does not have any parameters. It means that there is no further information that comes with this function. The onDInit function, on the other hand, has a parameter, which is an integer parameter, and it is called reason. This means that we would be able to use this reason variable in the body of the onDInit function. And this is the same procedure for the iStochastic function. When we call the iStochastic function, we have to also define some parameters so the computer knows what exact indicator we want to produce. So these parameters, which are separated by commata, are all the relevant information for the computer to define an unique indicator. So if you click on this word here, iStochastic, and you click F1 on your keyboard, it should automatically open the MQL5 reference. And there you have an entry for the iStochastic function. And at the very top, you can see the definition for this function. And you can also see the explanation. The function returns the handle of the stochastic oscillator indicator, which I already told you. And this function returns an integer value, which is indicated by this int, which is the abbreviation for integer, before the function name. So what we can do now is we can declare a variable with the name handle, and we can, with this equal sign, we can use the return value of the iStochastic function and store it in the handle variable. I will explain the whole process of declaring and addressing variables in a second. But first of all, let us fill the relevant parameters for this iStochastic function. The function has in total 7 parameters, and they have different types. All these types are have their specific meaning. So a type is pretty much a variable type, and you need different types because there are different values stored in different variables. So maybe we can explain the most important of them. You have integer variables, which are numbers. You have double variables, which are numbers with digits. You have string variables, which are text. You have which is text. You have bool variables, which can contain only two states, true and false. So this is the most basic variable, pretty much. And you also have, let me check some more of these. You will have enumerations, but this is a little bit different. We will get to that later. You have datetime variables, which contains times. And yeah, you have some more variable types, like some specific, like color, which can contain color types. But what you can see right now is all these variable types, they have a specific function, because you need an integer variable, like the one we declared up here, to store numbers. And you need a double variable to store numbers with digits. And at this point, there might be the question in your mind, why is there a difference? Why can't you use double variables for everything, maybe? And the difference is, which you can also read in the documentation, of course. If you go to int, for example, you can see a list of all the important variable types. You can see that these, if you read the text, you can see that there is a different size for the variables. For example, the integer type has it needs 4 bytes to be stored in the random access memory of your computer. And if you go to double, for example, it needs 8 bytes. So the double variable consumes a larger space in the memory of your computer. And for this reason, and for the reason of handling and everything, you need different types. So it would be inefficient to use the double variable for every number, for example. And it would not lead to the right result, because by defining different variable types, you can also show your computer if it is a number which it has to expect at the specific point in the random access memory, or if it is, for example, a text. And if you do not use the right variable type, the computer might be confused, because if I say this is a text, it is simply wrong, and it will be stored in a different way in the memory. And if you want to address this variable later on, it will lead to a wrong result. So make sure to always use a variable type that fits for this specific situation. So in this case, we need an integer type, because as you can see here, the istochastic function creates a handle, which is indeed an integer type. So let us have a look at the parameters for this function. You can see the first one is a string parameter, which is, as we learned before, a text. Maybe I can go back to this list so you can read it while we program. So it demands a text information, which is the name of the symbol that we or for which we want to create this iStochastic or the stochastic indicator. And the symbol we want to use is euro US dollar. So we can write euro US dollar like this. And make sure to always place your text in these quotation marks. So this is an indication for the computer that there is a text in between of quotation marks, and you always have to do it like this, because if you erase the quotation marks, this would lead to an error. So make sure to place texts in quotation marks every single time. And we might do it like this, but this is not really functional. So what happens if I want to use the US dollar Japanese yen chart, for example? In this case, I would have to go to the source code and write US dollar Japanese yen. So this is not really practical. What we can do, what is a better solution, is to simply use the system variable underscore symbol. And if I go to the reference again by clicking F1 on the underscore symbol name, you can see the entry for this. And this always contains the symbol name of the current chart. So whenever I activate the Expert Advisor in the euro US dollar chart, this symbol variable will contain euro US dollar. And if I do the same on the US dollar Japanese yen chart, the symbol variable will automatically contain the word in quotation marks US dollar Japanese yen. So this is a great way to define the symbol, because it is always the right symbol for the relevant chart. So let us have a look at the next parameter. I will go back to the iStochastic entry here, and we can see that there is a period requested. And the period has a rather strange type. The type is enum timeframes, and enum always indicates an enumeration. And if I go to this, the explanation for the period parameter, you can see there is the enum timeframes, which is colored. So I can click on it and go to the specific entry in the reference. And you can see there are several IDs for this enumeration. And I can use all these IDs. I can use any of these IDs to place here. So I can simply write period current, for example, which will always use the current time frame of the underlying chart for this and pretty much place it on this position. So I will always have the current chart here. So this is a great way to use, and it is better than simply saying period H1, because what happens if I go to the M15 charts? There is a difference between the chart that I see and the stochastic indicator that is calculated. But you can always choose a different time frame than the time frame of the underlying chart. And there might be situations where this is better. But in this case, I will just use period current. And now I need to define the settings for the indicator. So if we have a look at the indicator in the MetaTrader 5, we can see that this indicator has several settings. For example, the K period, the D period, the slowing, the price field, and the method for averaging. And all these inputs are requested for our iStochastic function, of course, because we have to tell the PC what exact stochastic indicator we want to work with. And I can simply define these inputs with integer data. So I can simply write, for example, I think the standard value is, let me have a look at it. It is 5, 3, and 3, so 5 for K, 3 for D, and 3 for the slowing. I can do it like this. I simply provide these three numbers without digits to make sure it is an integer number. And now we have to provide the MA method, which is the type of averaging. And if you click on Enum MA method, you can see that these are the possible options, mode SMA, mode EMA for the exponential, then the smoothed and the linear weighted averaging. I will simply use the mode SMA, which should be the standard setting. And as a last parameter, there is the price field requested, which we already saw here in the settings for the stochastic oscillator. And the standard setting is, I think, low high, so we will use this for this stochastic indicator in our program code. So you already realized that I used another enumeration, which is explained here, and it contains two values, two possible values, low high and close close, which are the exact options that we have for this stochastic indicator. Okay, so this is a way to define the stochastic indicator, and I will now erase these lines so there will be no errors. So what I did now is I defined a handle for the stochastic indicator, and if I print this handle, we can also visualize it. So let's go back to the toolbox, and you can see whenever I change the time frame, you will see that there are different numbers printed on this expert log. And these numbers are different whenever I choose a different time frame. So for example, the M30 time frame has the number 11. The M15 time frame has the number 10. The H1 time frame has the number 13. If I go back to one of these time frames, the number repeats, but only for this specific time frame. And this is because the functionality in the MetaTrader 5 programming is handle based for indicators. So somewhere in the memory of your computer, the MetaTrader 5 will store all the relevant information for a specific indicator, and by using a number like 10, 11, 12, the expert advisor knows at which exact position in your memory the information for this specific indicator is stored. So you can see whenever I go to the M15 chart, it is the number 10, because there is the indicator stored at, we can say, address 10 in the random access memory. There is the information stored for this specific stochastic indicator, which has the period 10 minutes. And if I go to another period, like M30, it is stored at address 11 pretty much. And this is like how you can understand the handle functionality. So by using a specific handle, which is unique for this indicator, the computer automatically knows all the information for this specific indicator because it is stored at a specific point in the random access memory. And what I want to do now is, this is not really functional because everything is hard coded and we cannot change the settings for this indicator without looking into the program code. What we can do now is we can exchange these hard-coded parameters with variables. For example, with variables for the K-period. K-period, we can say it is an integer variable, of course, stochastic K-period, and it has the value 5. And this is the stochastic K-period, and we can copy this by using copy, and we can paste it at this position here. And if I compile now, you can see there is no error. And this is the outcome is pretty much exactly the same, because we said already that this stochastic K period variable stores the value 5. So whenever the program or the computer gets to this point, it will see that there is a variable, and it will look in the memory of the computer where this variable is stored. And then it will see that there is indeed the value 5 stored in this variable. So it exchanges the name of the variable with the number 5. That's pretty much how working with variables is done. And this line, let me explain this line one more time. So it says that there is an integer variable declared and it has a name. So first of all, you have the type of the variable. This is important because the computer has to know how much space it has to reserve for this variable. As I already mentioned before, different variable types have a different size. So for an integer type, it will reserve 4 bytes in the memory. For a double type, it would reserve 8 bytes in the memory. And this is important because the computer has to look where is enough space for this variable and where can I put it, pretty much. And then you have a name for this variable. It can be pretty much everything which is not predefined, and it is up to you what name you choose, but you should of course choose a name that pretty much shows what kind of value is stored in this variable. It makes it easier to work with later on. And if I end this line, this would be fine. We can end this line with a semicolon, and this would simply reserve a space of 4 bytes somewhere in the random access memory. And by using this equal sign, I can also initialize this value in the same line. So if I do this after the declaration, I can already say, I do not only want to reserve the space, I also want to make sure that there is the number 3 stored in this variable at this specific point in the random access memory. So we have the value 3 stored somewhere in the memory, and the name of the variable is used to address this point. So the name is pretty much the address in the random access memory for this value. And that's how you can think of variables. So by using the name of the variable, which is pretty much the address of this variable, of this value in the random access memory of your computer, you can address the variable and, in this case, the value 5. Because this stochastic k-period stores the value 5. If I write name here, it would be the number 3 instead. Okay, so let us do the same for the d period and the slowing. I can just I can just copy this line and I can write d period. I can initialize it with the number 3, and I can write slowing for the slowing period, and I can also give it the number 3. Now I have to exchange the hard-coded numbers with the names of the variables. Stochastic slowing. Now, there might be another question in your mind, which is, what is better now? Nothing is better now, because if you want to change the settings, you still have to go in the program code and do the changes here. But there is a modifier for variables, and it is called input. I can write input before the name, before the type and the name of a variable, and you can see it already changes something, because this variable name becomes red or brown. It is colored. And if I do it for all 3 of these, or maybe for 2 of these for the moment, you can see that these 2 become they get a different color, and this indicates that these are input variables now. So if I go to the stochastic trader settings in the Expert Advisor, I can see the inputs tab at the top, and you can see there are 2 lines: the stochastic K period and the stochastic D period. And I am allowed to change these values here. So if I click on OK, this would lead to a change of this variable. So this would no longer contain the value 5, but 6 instead for this executed expert advisor. And this is a great way to enable settings for the user. So if I go ahead and print stochastic k period, maybe in the onInit function, you can see that whenever I change the value, a different value is printed. So I can change it to whatever I want, and the value of the variable changes. So this is a great way to enable settings for the user. And I can also do this for enumerations, for example. What I have to do now is, instead of using the integer type, I have to use the type pretty much of this enumeration. And you can see we have the enumeration MA method, for example. So I can simply use this to define the stochastic method, and the type is, yeah, of course, by default mode SMA, but I can now use the stochastic method here, and I can also define another input enumeration, which is the stochastic price field, which is stochastic low high by default. And if I exchange the hard-coded word here with the variable, we have the possibility to modify everything here. And you can see enumerations have a great benefit in the settings. They enable a drop-down menu with all the possible inputs. Okay, so this is it for defining the stochastic indicator. And now this is a lot of explanation and a lot of talking for simply explaining the handle concept in the MetaTrader 5. But it is kind of important, because once we have this handle, we can now use it to receive values from this indicator. And I will show you what we can do now. We can now use this handle for another function. This will lead to an error, but I show you something. We can say copy buffer, because indicators have different buffers, which are used to store the values. And you can see on every bar, there is in the data window a different value for the stochastic and the signal line. So these values are stored in buffers. Buffers are great, used for the different values, and because every single bar in the chart needs to have a different value, you need big buffers to store all these information. And we can copy the buffer of a specific indicator by using the predefined copy buffer function. If you are interested, you can of course read all the explanation in the reference, but this would, I think, be too much for this tutorial. So we can say copy buffer, and like pretty much every function, there are different parameters that are requested for this function. First of all, a handle. And this is great, because we have a handle. We have a handle up here. We can use this handle, and this will help the copy buffer function to realize which exact indicator we want to read. And now we have to provide a buffer number. This indicator has two buffers, the stochastic line, the signal line, and they they start with zero. So you can simply count them, 0, 1. If there would be another buffer, it would be 2. So first of all, we have to provide buffer 0, for example, to read or to receive the data for the stochastic line. And now we have to provide a starting position, which might be 1, and a count, which might be 2. I will explain that later on. And we can write stochastic here. So this will lead to several errors, as you can see here. And we will handle these errors now. First of all, it says that it does not know the name handle. It does not know this identifier. And this is because we defined this integer variable with a name handle in the onInit function. Right now, we are in the body of the onTick function. And you are not allowed to use variables from another function in the body of a different function. So what we have to do now is we have to define this handle name, this handle variable, outside of any function. Because this is a matter of scope. Whenever it comes to scope in programming, there's a definition pretty much for it, and it is upside down, if I can explain it like this. Whenever I define something on the very on the outside scope of anything, it can be addressed in a smaller scope. So this is the so-called global scope for this program. It is outside of any function, so it can be addressed in every single function. If I declare a variable, for example, in the onInit function, I can only use it in the onInit function. And if I go to an even smaller scope, maybe I have a structure in here, like an if structure, which we will get to know later on. If I would define the handle here, I would not be able to use the handle here, because it is only defined inside of this smaller scope. And yeah, so in this case, I have to define it on the global scope to make it addressable in any of these functions. So now I can provide a value, or I can store a value in this handle variable in the onInit function, and I can receive this value in the onTick function, and you should see that there is no error anymore. There is another error because the copy buffer function does not know the stochastic identifier, and this is of course because I did not define the stochastic variable. The stochastic variable will be an array of the double type, and these are two new words pretty much. First, double, but I explained it before, it's just a different type of numbers, because these numbers might have digits. And because we want to store prices in this array, we have to use a number with digits, because prices very often contain digits. As you can see here, the price might be 1.17630, and so we need a number that can, or a variable type that can contain digits. And after the name of this variable, we have these square brackets. So this is the third type of brackets. We already know round brackets, curly brackets, now we know these squared brackets. They are used to identify an array. An array is used when you not only have one double variable, but you want to have more than one double variable. For example, this array might contain three double variables, and it is important to show the computer that there might be more than one double value stored in this variable, because the computer has to choose a different place in the random access memory. It will have to choose a place where is more space for different double variables. So 8 bytes might not be enough if we want to store 5 double variables, which would contain 40 bytes instead. So this is a double array, and we can provide this array to our copy buffer function, because the function will use this array to store all the prices in it. And this leads to these two parameters, which I did not explain yet. This is the starting position and the count. And To explain it, we have to have a look at the chart. The chart is based on bars, and every bar has an index. The last bar always has the index 0, the second last bar has the index 1, this is the index 2, this is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I think you get it by now. So these the count always starts at the latest bar. And if there would be a new bar, because, for example, 30 minutes passed in this chart, the new bar would now be index 0. And this would be index 1, this would be index 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. So we can use this indexing functionality to show which indicator value we want to receive. So we start at index 1, which would be the last bar, this bar. So we want to receive the values for this bar, and the count is 2. So we do not only want to receive this value, but we also want to receive this value. So the count starts at the starting index, which is 1, and then we count 1, 2. So these two values would be stored in the stochastic array. And if I now print the values, we can say stochastic 0 and stochastic 1. Please do not be confused by this line. I will explain it real quick. If you want to receive values from an array, you always have to write these square brackets after the indicator name, after the array indicator name, and you will have to provide the index of the value you want to receive. Arrays, the counting for arrays also starts at 0. So, yeah, there are two values in this array, because we said we want to store two values. So we have the index 0 and 1. And we can use these indexes to address a specific value in the array. This sounds rather complicated, and starting to work with arrays is kind of confusing, but you will get the hang of it the more you use it. So I can simply print these two numbers here, and I can separate several information in the print function by commata. And if I compile it, and if I show you the result in the tester, you can see that there's also the last, always the last, the values for the last two bars that are printed. And if we have a look at the stochastic value here, you can see that for the last bar, it is a 20.43, which is printed at the experts tab, and the bar before that contains the value 17.90. And if I go to another bar, I can increase the speed of the tester. Maybe we go here. You can see that it always adapts, because of this indexing of the bars, we will always have the latest bars for our calculation. You can see now this bar contains the value 46.80, and this bar contains the value 45.14. I think, yeah, the bar just changed. So yeah, you can see this is working. Of course, the values are rounded, because here we have two digits and here we have all the digits. Okay, so this is already working, and we are now able to receive the values for the stochastic line of the stochastic indicator. We can now do the very same, but we use the buffer number 1. Everything else will be the same, except for the array. We now have to use another array, which we can call, for example, signal array. And if we do this, we will now, of course, also receive the values for the signal line. And by doing so, we now have all the relevant information for our trading signals. I can now write an if statement, which I will explain in a second, to to scan for trading signals. I can, for example, say that the stochastic value for the last bar has to be above the signal value for the last bar, and the stochastic value at the bar before the last bar has to be below the signal value of the bar before the last bar. This would be a buy signal, I think. And I can do the same, or the opposite pretty much, to check for sell signals. What I do now is I've read the same line pretty much, but I use different comparison signs, sell signal. Okay, if I do it like this and compile, there is no error. Oh, there is an error. I have to do. I did something wrong. Ah, I forgot an if. Okay, if I compile it now, there is no error. And let me explain an if statement real quick. If the word if is simply the identifier, so the computer knows there will be an if statement following. And then you have these round brackets. Round brackets for an if statement indicate the condition. So in between of these opening and closing round bracket, there is the condition for this if statement. And it is a specific value has to be greater than another specific value. And there's another condition, which compares two other values. And the whole condition is only true if both of these single conditions are true. So this is pretty much a condition which checks if there is a crossover in the last two bars. And if it is indeed true, then we will enter the body of this if statement. And then we will do everything that is in between of these curly brackets. If this condition is not true, then we do not enter the body and we automatically go on here in line 35 at the moment. And there we have an else if, which can, every if statement can be continued with an else if. And I can do this as long as I want. I can always check more conditions by adding more else ifs. And in this else if, there is a different condition, because these comparison operators are the other way around. So I check another condition, and if this condition is true, then we enter the body of this second if statement, and we will write a different print statement. So let me compile this. Let us have a look at it in the strategy tester real quick. I have to restart it, and let us see if we can capture the right signals here. I hope this will be working. We can see there are signals. Let us now real quick check the relevant indicator. We do not see it right now. I will restart it and hope that the indicator is shown. I think this is kind of a bug in the MetaTrader, because sometimes it shows the indicator, yeah, below the chart, and sometimes it does not show the indicator, but we'll have a look at it. So let us look in the experts journal here at the bottom in the toolbox, and you can see there are several signals. I will wait until this is finished and everything is printed, and you can see the last information was printed at the first of August, September, I don't know. You can see it is printed at 16:34 and 95 seconds. And if we have a look, this is the last tick in, it should be the last tick in this bar, 53, wait a second. Yeah, it is the last pick in this bar, because after this bar it would be the minute would change. So in the last tick of this bar there was the last print statement printed, and this is because in the last two bars before this bar there was indeed a crossover. And if we look at the signal before that, it should be a cell signal at 1604, and this should be here. It is not here. Is there a problem? No, there is no problem. So the change took place in between of these two bars, and it was printed in this bar. Okay, this is working. This is working. We now can identify the change or the crossover of these two lines. And what we want to do now is, you see there are several signals, and this is a great, this is a big problem, because if we now do the opening for the positions here, we would have several positions for every signal, because with every tick this condition is true for a whole bar, and this is not good. So we have to make sure that every bar is only processed once for this piece of code. So what we can do now is we can say int bars, or we can say int total bars, which is a new global, very important, variable. And in our on init function, we can say total bars is equal to the return value of the iBars function for the underlying symbol for the period current. So what this does is the iBars function returns the amount of bars in the specific chart. So what we can do now is we can receive the bars again. Now we can use a local variable for this function, because we will use this variable only in this function, and we can do the same. We receive the amount of bars for this chart, and now we can check if the total bars is different from the bars variable, and then we can update the value in the total bars variable with the amount of bars that are currently in the chart. And if we move this whole piece of code up here, then we will, as a result, only process everything inside of this if statement here only once. So another important thing is, whenever you use a, whenever you go to a smaller scope, which is in most cases indicated by curly brackets, you move the code some spaces to the right. And you can use it by using the tabulator button on your keyboard. This is important because it makes your code much more easier to read. Because if everything is only on the same level, you cannot see with one view, which is a smaller scope. But if I move this to the right, I can see in a split second that this is another scope than this. Okay, so this is just for reading purposes, and for structuring your code. It does not really affect the program, because I can do it like this. This looks ugly, but it does work. So this is just for you. So if you want to look at your code in a year or two, you're still able to read it, and you won't hate your past self. So if I do it like this, we can now make another test, and you will see that all these unnecessary print statements will not be there anymore. So I can increase the speed, and you can see buy and sell signals now, they now take turns. So this is much more better. And I can now in the next step open positions, because we already erased the problem of having multiple positions for one signal. So whenever we want to open positions in the MetaTrader 5, it is the best way is to use the ctrade class. This will be super confusing for you now, if you do not have any coding experience, but we will make it easy. Just write as I do. You use this hashtag sign here, you write include, and then you write trade MQH, and you compile this. And what we did now is we included another file into our MQ5 document here. And you can see in the navigator on the left side, you can see an include folder, and you can see the trade folder and the trade.mqh file. And this is the file that we just address here. And we include this file. If you do a double click, you can see this is a file which will be rather confusing for you if you do not have any coding experience. But all you have to know is we have all this information, all this source code. We have it now inside of our program. We can use everything that is inside here in our own program now, which enables us to use the C-trade class. And we can now create a object variable with a type C-trade, which is named trade. I cannot cover it completely in this beginner's tutorial because this would open several topics like object-oriented programming, which is not easily explained in 10 minutes. So just do as I do here, and you can declare a C-trade variable pretty much with the name trade. And this trade variable can now be used to open positions. So this trade variable if you address the trade variable, you write this dot after the identifier for this variable, you can see several functions which we can now use. So, for example, we can use the buy function, and as the name says, this opens a buy position. And we can use the round brackets for this function to provide different information, so the computer knows what exact position we want to open. And for example, we can define the volume. I always use a input variable for this because it makes it much more easier for the user to define the volume that he wants to trade. For example, we can say we want to trade 0.1 lots, and we can use this input variable down here to indicate that we want to indeed open 0.1 lots for this specific symbol, which is the second requested parameter. We can of course use a predefined symbol variable. Then we have to provide a price. For a simple market buy position, we of course want to use the ask price, and we can receive it by using the symbol info double function. This function needs a symbol and a ID for the symbol specific property. So the symbol info double function, you can see it in the reference, of course, has different identifiers as a second parameter, which will indicate what kind of information you want to receive for a specific symbol. And like this, we want to receive the bit price for this symbol. And the symbol info double function, of course, returns this specific price, and we can store it in the ask variable, which is not clever, of course, because we should request the ask variable if you want to, the ask price if we want to store it in the ask variable. And we can now use this ask variable as an open price, which is what is also important. If you want to work with prices, you should also always round them to a specific amount of digits. And you can do it by using the normalize double function, which is a function, if you look in the reference, to rounds to a specific floating point. So we can say we have the ask value, and we want to round it to the amount of digits for this specific symbol. Digits is just like symbol. Underscore symbol underscore digits is a predefined variable which always has the amount of digits for the underlying symbol. In this case, the underscore digits variable would return 5, and the call of the normalize double function would lead to the rounding of our ask value to a precision of 5. And now we can use the ask variable to open a position at the ask price. And yeah, I have several more parameters, but you can see by these equal signs, they also have predefined values. So I am not forced to provide different values for these parameters since they have predefined values. And I can just close the parameter section with these round brackets, close the line with a semicolon, and this would work. I will now copy all three lines down here for the cell signal, and I will do some modifications, of course, because we want to open at the bid price, we want to receive the bid price, we want to round the bid price, and we want to sell at the bid price. Everything else will stay pretty much the same. And if we start the program one more time, we can now see that we are able to open positions whenever there is a signal. And this is super cool because we do not have it, we do not have to sit in front of the computer and wait for signals the whole day, but the computer can do this stuff for us, and we will now get several positions whenever there is a signal. And you can see this looks kind of messy because we do not close these positions. We have different options. We might use a close function to close a position at a specific point, but we can also provide a stop loss and a take profit for these positions to automatically close if we reach one of the levels. So what I like to do is define TP points and SL points at the top of the program code in the area where we define the input variables. So we can say maybe TP and SL of 100 points. A point in the MetaTrader 5 programming is always the smallest number of the last digit. So for example, in the Euro US dollar chart, a point would be 0.00001. And we can now use this these input variables to define the TP and the SL for our positions. So first of all, let us go with the symbol. Let us go with the TP for the buy position. So we can use our ask entry price, and we can add the TP points, and we multiply it with the point variable, which, as I already said, is a point for the underlying symbol. For example, in the Euro US dollar chart, this would be 0.00001. And if we multiply it with the amount of points, we would get, if the amount of TP points is 100, we would get a value of 0.001. Yeah, and this will be added to the ask price to receive the TP. And we, of course, want to round this, so there are no problems with digits. And we then subtract the SL points from the ask price to receive the SL value here. And now we only have to provide these two values to the buy function here to make sure that we trade with an TP and an SL. I will write the SL first. This does not affect the function, but this is the order they are requested in the buy function here. And I can do the same, of course, for the sell side here. And I simply have to change something because, of course, we want to subtract the SL points from the bid value. We want to, this was not right. We want to add the SL points to the bid value, and we want to subtract the TP points from the bid value for the TP. So let me provide these two values here. And if we do another test run, we should see that every position now has a TP and an SL, which leads to the closing of the position if either one is reached. And yeah, if I run this now, you can see positions are opened and closed, and we can also see there is a a graphical indication of the performance that we would have if we traded it for this specific time in the past. Of course, this can be good or bad, doesn't really matter right now, because this is just the programming. And what we would have to do now is we would have to test with different settings. But the great thing is, since we use input variables, we can use, even in the tester, different settings to test different strategies. For example, we could say we want to have a TP of 500 points and an SL of 250 points. And we can also go to the H1 chart or the M30 chart, and we can test again. And this is maybe the biggest benefit of the programming of automated trading strategies. We can test so fast. It is crazy. We can test years in a matter of minutes. And if you want to do this with pen and paper, it would take probably days or months to test years for a single strategy. So now we have a different different settings for the TP and the SL, and we should see that the SL is now smaller than the TP, pretty much. And this will lead to a different equity curve, which we can see here. So yeah, feel free to test different settings and find the settings that fit your trading style the best. So, but we are not done yet. We now have really simple and easy if conditions, because we are just checking if there is a crossover. What we can do now is we can add a filter. So we can say we only want to trade if the market was overbought or oversold before. So we have to define two boundaries at the top in the input variable section. We can say stochastic upper bound, for example, and we can say it is 80, and we can say the stochastic lower bound. Lower bound will be 20. And what we can do now is we can add another if statement here. And maybe we can do it like this. We can check if the stochastic value, if the last stochastic value is smaller than the stochastic lower bound, maybe, or smaller or equal, or the signal, the last signal value is smaller than the stochastic lower bound. And only if one of this is true, then we have a signal. So to make it completely correct, we should move this down here, and we should say by crossover, and only if it is started below the lower bound, we want to have a buy signal. Let us do the same for the sell side. We can say sell crossover, and we can say if stochastic at the last bar is greater or equal stochastic upper bound, or signal, the signal line at the last bar is greater or equal the stochastic upper bound, then we want to have a real signal that we want to trade. So we say sell signal like this, and the uppercase letter. And now we should also filter several signals. You can see, once you have the raw structure for your program, and once you have the indicator handle and everything, it is really easy and really it is really quick to add more filters and stuff like that to modify your program. So let me start it again so we can see the indicator at the bottom. I don't know what this bug is. It is kinda annoying, but yeah, we just have to deal with it. Okay, so there is the stochastic indicator. We can see this was indeed a correct signal, but you can also see if we have a look at this specific crossover on the 4th of September, we can see that there is a indicated crossover, but there is no signal. So this is caused by the filter that we just added. So yeah, we made some more modifications for our program, and the outcome is different now. We of course have a different graph again. So this is not really beneficial, I think, but it is too soon to say something. And if you see some results like this, it is also a possibility to just exchange the signals. So maybe you can sell if you have a buy signal, you can buy if you have a sell signal. So this is all the power that comes with programming. So you are not forced to use a single strategy for your whole life. You are able to take modifications whenever you want it. So this is working really good, I think. So there's one last thing that I promised you in the beginning, that we will add a trailing stop. And you can add a trailing stop by using a loop. And this is something new that we will learn. We can use a for loop, and I will explain in a second what a for loop does. Wait a second, positions total. I will write the most important part of it real quick, and then I will explain. Okay, so this is a for loop. Loop is always used if we want to do a step multiple times. So when the program enters the line 40, it will see that a for loop is used because there is the word for, of course. And then there are some conditions which are in curly brackets, in round brackets. And the precondition is the declaration of an integer variable. So this precondition is only executed once for this for loop. So when we enter the for loop, a new integer variable with the name I is declared, and the value of the positions total, the return value of the positions totals function subtracted by one is stored in the I variable. The positions total function returns the number of open positions. It is a predefined function that we can use in the MQL5 framework. And the number of positions is, of course, changing. So in this case, it would return 3, subtracted by 1 is 2. So when we enter this for loop, I would be initialized with the number 2. And then we have the condition that is checked before every single run of this loop. And it checks if I is greater or equal 0. In this case, I is 2, so this condition would be true. After checking this condition, and if it is true, we go to the body of the for loop. And we do whatever is in here. Processed. This will be processed if I is greater or equal 0. And after processing all the source code in the body of the for loop, we now go to the last condition here. And all these conditions you can see are separated by semicolons. You can see this I variable is decreased by 1. So this minus minus is the same as writing I minus 1. So this is exactly the same. And minus minus is just a easier way of writing. So after subtracting 1 from I is now 1. And we will not go to the precondition again, as I already mentioned, but instead we will automatically go to this condition after decreasing I by 1. And we'll now check if 1 is greater or equal 0, and this is indeed true, so we will go to the body again, we will subtract 1 from I, we will check this again, I is 0, so it is still greater or equal 0, so we will process this again, and then we subtract 1 again from 0, which leads, which will result to minus 1, and now minus 1 is not greater or equal 0, so we will leave the for loop and we will process the rest of the code. So this is a for loop explained real quick. So inside of this for loop, we can now check if and we can now check the positions. So we can use the position get ticket function, and we now have to provide a position index. And the position index is our I. So if I provide I, we will now get the ticket of the position at the position at the position I. And we start at position 2, then we check position 1, and then we check position 0 for 3 orders. And this is because if we have 3 orders, they are counted from 0 to 2. So this might be order 0, this is 1, this is 2. And by using the index of these positions, we get the ticket number of each of them in a different for loop run. So now we have the ticket. Now we can say we want to select a position by using a specific ticket number. So we can provide the ticket number that we just received, and we can say we now want to receive different parameters of this position. And we can say, for example, we can receive the open price by saying position get double, and just like the symbol info double, we now can receive every possible double value from the latest selected position. So we can say position get double, position price open. So the open price of this selected position will be stored in this double variable. And we can do the same, of course, for the SL, for the TP, and for every other parameter of this selected position. So first of all, for the SL, then for the TP, and then we can also receive the position type. Now we have to use the position get integer function, but we can say we want to have the position type. The position type is either enum position by, and I can show it to you real quick. The position enum position type. There are several types. Position type by and position type cell, and we will use these two to identify if it is a buy or a sell position, because based on this decision, we will make the calculation for the trading stop. So we now have the position type. And what we can do now is we can check if the position type is equal position type buy. So this indicates that there is a buy position that we just selected. And if this is not true, then we should check if it might be a position type sell. And based on these conditions, we can now say that inside of these curly brackets, we will for sure process a buy position. So we now have to define a new trading stop. And what I want to show is a trading stop that will always guarantee a chance risk ratio of 1. For example, so what we want to do is we check the possible win, which we receive if we subtract the position open price. That was wrong. If we subtract the bid price from the position TP, because we are already at a specific point towards the TP. And we now check the range that is left until we reach the take profit. So what we have to do now is we have to receive the bid price for the symbol, what we already did before. So we write symbol info double, symbol, symbol bid. And we can also copy the line already for the ask price. Symbol ask, because we need it for the sell position. So we subtract the bid price from the TP, and what we do now is we rewrite we get a new SL, and this new SL will be initialized with a value of the bid price minus the possible win. And if we do it like this, we can now, of course, round the new SL. SL is like normalized double, new SL, and we round it to the precision of the amount of digits. And this should calculate the new SL, so we will ensure that we can only lose as much as we are able to win at this point of time. So we can now say trade.positionModify, and we can now modify a position which is identified by the ticket, which we have stored in our ticket variable. And now we have to provide a new SL and a TP, which is the old TP. We will not modify it. If this worked, we can now print, for example, position ticket was modified by trailing stop loss. So we will make sure that we know what happened by reading the expert's log. And now all I have to do is copy this for the cell side or for the cell positions. And we will have to make some adjustments, because here we will have to ask, subtract the position TP from the ask price. And the new SL is, of course, ask plus possible win. And the rounding process is the same, and the modification is also the same. Here is a warning which we can ignore pretty much, but if you do not want to ignore, you can cast this return value to the enum position type. The cast is pretty much insurance for the computer that this is indeed a value that is contained in this enumeration. This might be confusing, but it does not really change the outcome of the program, but it will remove the warning. So if we do everything like this, we should now have a trailing stop which can be used to modify the SL whenever we move into the direction of the TP. And you can see this is working, but there is one big problem. Whenever the the price is running into the wrong direction, the SL is also modified. So we have to ensure one last thing. So the SL shall only be modified if it is greater than the position SL for a buy position, and if it's smaller than the position SL for a sell position. So if the new SL is smaller than the position SL, or the position SL is zero, this could be the case if there is no SL, so this is important to handle for sell positions. If I compile it again, this should be working fine just now. So let me check it again for you. So the SL is not modified yet, but if the price price is going south, there is a modification of the trailing stop. And even for buy positions, this is working pretty good. So I think that's all I wanted to do in this tutorial. And if you are still coding with me, and if you followed the whole process of creating this expert advisor, I'm super glad, and I hope that you learned something. And let us to sum up, just check the lines in this program real quick again to make sure that you get the whole structure of the program. So first of all, we have different properties which are not important for the outcome of the program. We included the trade MQH that folder and the trade MQH file, so we are able to use this ctrade class for easy access to all the trading functionalities. And then we have several input variables which are indicated by the input code word, and these are variables that can be modified by the user in the settings area, the inputs area of the expert advisor. And after that, we have three more global variables, which are also outside of any function. So we can use them inside of any functions, but they are no input variables. So the user is not allowed to modify them, and the user does not have to modify them. And the onInit function, which is called once the program is initialized, we then get our total bars updated, because we use this total bars variable to realize later on in the onTick function whenever there is a new bar and when we have to check for new trading signals. And afterwards, we define our stochastic handle, which we explained like really detailed and long, but I think it is important so you understand the working with handles in the MetaTrader 5, which is a key concept in the programming and in the working with indicators. So the onInit function is not used by us, so it is completely blank. We could even erase it and it would not change the outcome of the program, but since it is one of the three most important functions, in my opinion, I will always leave it in the program, just in case you want to use it later on. And then the heart of our program, the most important part, is of course the onTick function. And here we first of all check the trailing stop, where we have a for loop that iterates over all the positions, and we select different positions, and then we check if we have a new if we have to modify the stop loss, if our new calculated SL is above or greater than the old SL for buy positions or below the old SL for sell positions, then we modify it using the trade object variable here. And yeah, that's it for the trailing stop. And then we enter a new block. And this block is only executed if there is a new bar, which we ensure in these lines. And there we check the indicator values. We first receive them using the copy buffer function. We store them in two arrays, and then we use these arrays to compare the values inside of them to search for crossovers and then for signals if the filter condition is met. And if everything is fine, then we use the trade object variable to open positions using the buy function. So that's it pretty much. So this is a rather simple program. We only used 120 lines, and it still enables us to test for multiple years, tens of years, and multiple markets, every market pretty much, and so many different settings. So this could lead to an analysis session that takes weeks, but you can scan different markets super, super fast. And you can, of course, always use this program for your live or demo trading. Please make sure before you use this program or any program in live trading, make sure that you completely understand what the program does. Make sure that you tested it for multiple days, maybe for months in a demo account, and that there are no unexpected errors or situations that might lead to a financial decrease of your account. So please always take responsibility for your own trading, for your own programming. This program is not, it is not a perfectly final program. There would be one or two additions that I would make before I use it in live trading, but I mean, you can use it in live trading, but please be super, super, please double check it very often, and do not trade many other positions if you use this program for your trading. But I hope that you learned something. I'm glad that you followed me to this point. Please subscribe to this channel if you want to learn more about automated trading. And please, what is very important, if you have anyone in your anyone of your friends, maybe of your family, who might also be interested in programming, expert advisors, please share this video, because it helps to talk to a greater audience, to enable more people to write their programs for the MetaTrader. And it will, of course, help me generate profits like partnerships and everything for this channel, which will motivate me to make more videos for you so we can all benefit from this content. Okay, so thank you so much for watching. We will see each other hopefully in the next episode, in the next video. Until then, have a great time, have good trades, and yeah, I will see you then. Bye bye.